بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه أما بعد we continue بفضل الله سبحانه وتعالى our session of المعهد and we're starting with the fiqh as we get inshallah to going on to this path the fiqh then the aqidah and then we finish by the hadith inshallah in the fiqh the jurisprudence there's something very important before inshallah we start and resume from where we start the prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam he complimented the woman of al-ansar and the wisdom in the way that he complimented them to teach us the way how to always rush to get our deen. Even though some of the obstacle might stop someone to be more eager into getting his deen, some of this obstacle is the fact for someone he is shy, the sense of modesty, the sense of shyness. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam make dua toward the Nisa al-Ansar. Qala rahimallahu Nisa al-Ansar. La yamna'unna al-haya'u min al-tafaqquh fi-d-deen aw kama qala sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Shyness wasn't an obstacle for them to not learn their deen. So they went beyond that obstacle. Why? Because their target, their purpose is so high. Is to learn the way of their life, to learn the way how to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. With this introduction, we remind ourselves that in the book of the Tahara, we're going to talk about things that we're going to talk to it, you know, about it from the point of view of cleanliness, from the point of view of worship. And therefore, the question or the way of the, inshallah, relating and reading should not have for us to think of this obstacle because this is a ibadah, this is a worship. And subhanAllah, in this society, and this is for all of us, you know, as students of knowledge, in the society, people talk to the children about things that are fully haram and talking about the fahisha, and they do not tell them, do not do it, but they say, prevent yourself from diseases, etc. Alhamdulillah, in the way of Allah, the Muslim generation for a long time, they learn all that. But they learn, subhanAllah, from the point of view of purity, from cleanliness. Because in the book of the Tahara, everyone who goes to study it, he will learn everything about the cleanliness, and you know how the way someone, subhanAllah, need to approach this. You know that the haram, but we are talking about cleanliness, and then they're talking about like the evil doing in this subject. Walhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Therefore, if we want to approach our children or our young youth, is to approach them from this perspective, to teach them to talk, because this is ibadah, this is ibadah. The second thing that I want to, inshallah, as an observation, you see our scholars, rahimahumullah ta'ala, they go into details of many things. Talking about, you know, how many prayer we have depends on the number of the garment that are impure. But the question is, in these details for hardship or details for rahmah, we need to understand, where our scholars go on in depth just to make things difficult and make it like more structured and more rules or different things. It's really the one who doesn't know, you know, the intention of these great scholars, he will be thinking like the deen is all about rules and structure and forms, and it's not that. The greatest gift that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us in this life to serve Him, and the purpose of life is to serve Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as He said, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. Now, when someone he doesn't have enough sincerity, enough love to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he will make two things very casual. He doesn't really care. That's why Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu قَالَ لَتَشْهِيبَةُ عَارِضَةَ الْمَرْءِ فِي الْإِسْلَامِ وَلَمْ تُقْبَلْ لَهُ صَلَاةٌ. A man can have his hair get gray, you know, in Islam. So he grew up in Islam till he became very old. And no salat has been accepted from him. Why? Because he was so casual into doing his action of worship. He doesn't care how to do the wudu. Careless. I mean, he washes himself and he goes to the prayer, he's not concentrating. He's not praying to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now when you look at our scholars, rahimahullah, they have this, what we call al-wara. And al-wara is like extreme level, I will not say, but high rank of piety and righteousness, which lead them to be very sure to make things that they know that certainly they will be right for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept them. So let's look from this point of view, the beauty of this deen and the sincerity of our scholars and their wara to lead them to these details. So it's not making things, you know, like say hard and so structured, but it's like to give us the more way to see the rahmah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to be sincere also as in practicing our deen. Because as Ali radiallahu ta'ala an, when one time he was seeing the way he's making wudu in a very careful way, and he was so focused and concentrated when he's been asked why you are in this state, he said, I'm going about to fulfill an amana, a trust. I'm going to fulfill a trust that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala presented it to the heaven and the earth and the mountain, and they declined it. And who carry this trust, who is in charge to fulfill this trust is man. And he said, I'm about to fulfill it, which is, he presented it into the salah. He presented it into the salah. Therefore, when we go on the details, that's one of the beauty of this deen, to learn from the samt, from the akhlaq, from the behavior and the conduct of the scholars, and their way of thinking, how they were so sincere, how they were so attached to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They have this type of the wara. They want to do things, you know, in the way that it pleases Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Exactly how the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam taught them, and to be very careful. And that aspect help us to increase our iman and help us to beautify and improve the way of our worship. In the last, we were talking about Babul Aniyah, the book of the chapter of the Aniyah. And we went in Babul Aniyah talking about that the Aniyah, the container of the utensils, are Tahira, and the way to use it for the water, for example, and to make a wudu that will be accepted. And the scholar, the Musannif rahimahullah ta'ala, exclude from it, قَالَ يُبَاهُ اتِّخَاذُهُ وَاسْتِعْمَالُهُ. So the Aniyah, the utensil, it is lawful to use it and to take it and to keep it, even though it might be very expensive, valuable, except as we make the exclusion of Aniyatul Dhahab wal-Fudda, the Aniyah of out of silver and gold. وَمُضَبَّبًا بِهِمَا, the one that being joined and have like some solid, some of the silver in it. فَإِنَّهُ يُحْرَمُ اتِّخَاذُهَا وَاسْتِعْمَالُهَا. You cannot even use that, except for وَتَصِحُّ الطَّهَارَةُ مِنْهَا إِلَّا ضَبَّةً يَسِيرَةً مِنْ فُضَّةً. And it is lawful to use it for cleanliness when you put your water into the container that had ضَبَّةٌ مِنْ فُضَّةً. الضَبَّةُ, we said, this line that make it or use it to join a container that broke, and then they use it to join it and avoid any leaking of the water. بِحَاجَةٍ is for use. وَتُكْرَهُ مُبَاشَرَتُهَا لِغَيْرِ حَاجَةٍ. And that part which has fiqh, when someone is going to drink from it, he used not, he should not do it, because that's what the Prophet ﷺ said, don't use it for eating and drinking and to avoid that. But if there is no way except to drink from that part or to use it, then this is, will be the hajj. This is just a very brief summary of what we did last time. قال, and then comes to قال وَتُبَاحُ آنِيَةُ الْكُفَّارِ. وَتُبَاحُ آنِيَةُ الْكُفَّارِ. And here, تُبَاحُ, it is lawful to use the container or utensils of the disbeliever, those who are not Muslim. It is lawful to use them. the scholars, they have different of opinion in this mas'ala. First, aniyatul kuffari ala halatayn. The use or any container or pots or utensils used by non-followers of the Islamic faith has two states. The first state, أن تكون جديدة غير مستعملة. The first state, that's a new container, never touch, like the one you use and you, the one that you buy from the store, that doesn't have any objection or any talk about it, because they are new, and the fact that they are made out of material, things that are tahira, pure, so it is lawful to use it. So this one doesn't have any problem you're talking about. So يجوز الانتفاع بهذا الإجماع. It's a consensus among the scholars to use it because it's new, never been touched. As long as the container wasn't made out of a material of substance that is impure. The second case here is أن تكون أواني الكفار مستعملة. أن تكون أواني الكفار مستعملة. When these pots or utensils are used. In this, if they are used, if you see in the pot or the container impurity, so this is a consensus, so it's impure, you cannot use it till you clean it. And it is not possible to use it as long as it has najasa, because they might eat in it something that is haram. You see, like, you know, meat that is haram inside their pots, you cannot use it. That is najis. But if you clean it with the way of the cleanliness that you want to describe, inshallah, which is with the water, and you clean, as we mentioned it, and you remove all the traces of the impurity, then you can use it, because the substance that is made of it is halal, it's pure, therefore you bring it back to its purity by removing the najasa. وأما إذا كانت هذه الأواني مغسولة عندهم ولم يجد الإنسان غيرها. So if they are clean and someone didn't find anything else except that, and they used it for their food. Here we have two sayings of the scholars, rahimahullah. قال, the first opinion, لا يستعمل إلا أن يضطر إليها. So if they have pots, they used it and everything, they are washed and they are at the side, and someone, he only can use them only if he doesn't have anything else to use. So this is, let's say, in a state of need, not like his love, state of need. Muhtar was like a necessity because he didn't find any other container to use. And this one extracted from Hadith Abi Tha'labah, الخشني قال يا رسول الله إني بأرض قوم أهل كتاب أفآكل في آنيتهم. أبو ثعلبة, he asked the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said, I'm around a land where there is people of the book, should I eat from their container? وفي رواية أفنأكل في آنيتهم. In the other narration he asked in the plural, said, should we eat in their container? The Prophet ﷺ said, قَالَ لَا إِلَّا أَلَّا تَجِدُوا غَيْرَهَا فَغَسِلُوهَا ثُمَّ قُلُوا فِيهَا. The Prophet ﷺ said, no, you should not, except if you don't find any other pot, if you don't have any other container except these, then use it. Use it, of course, that already should be it being purified and cleaned. So this is hadith of Abu Thalaba al-Khashni. قال فدل هذا الحديث على أن آنية الكفار التي يستعملونها لا يؤكل فيها. So this is an evidence from this hadith that the any of the kuffar, the container of the people who not following the Islamic faith, should not someone use them unless he has a need, because he didn't find any other container. But we have another hadith that really, I will not say conflict, but it gives us the second opinion, and that's how we need to come to a conclusion from this opinion, inshallah, in our in this analysis in this class. The other hadith that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam istadafahu yahudiyun ala khubzin wa ihalatin sanikha. فَأَكَلَ النَّبِيُّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ مِنْ ذَلِكَ. One of the people of the book, Jew, he invited the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam for a meal. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam ate from what he presented for him. So the container used by the Jew is his own container and the food that he cooked. And the Prophet ate from it. وَكَذَلِكَ أَيْضًا ثَبَتَ فِي الصَّحِيحِ. It was always also proven in the Sahih, in the authentic hadith. When we say Sahih, it's either Al-Bukhari or Muslim, or it's been hadith graded Sahih. أَنَّ مْرَأَةً يَهُودِيَّةً دَعَتْهُ إِلَى شَاتٍ وَوَضَعَتِ السَّنَّ فِيهَا ثُمَّ أَطْعَمَتْهُ عَلَيْهِ الصَّلَاةُ وَالسَّلَامُ. أَطْعَمَتْهُ إِيَّهِ. The hadith, and you know the hadith that is a famous hadith because the effect of the poison, the Prophet ﷺ still have feeling it at the moment of his death. And this woman, Jew woman, who invited the Prophet ﷺ, brought them food, and she put the poison. And she saying, as excuse, if he's the Prophet, then he's God, he will save him. And if he's not, we'll get rid of him. But this is, look, the scholar, this hadith which is being used, as you see, in such things, evil done to the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, but also it is a hukum. It is, we bring out of it is a ruling. It's a law that the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is instructing us. So by eating from his her container, it gives us that it's lawful to use them. It's lawful to use them. And there's another hadith, say, someone can drink from them, make wudu for them. It is the hadith of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. It is narrated in As-Sahihain. When we say As-Sahihain, both Sahih, it means Sahih al-Bukhari wa Muslim. عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أنه لما لقي المرأة التي معها المزادة توضأ هو وأصحابه منها. The Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam in the travel, he saw a woman, she was mushrika, so non-believer, an idol worshiper, and she has mazada. Mazada is a container, and mainly made out of skin. And the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam used the water she has to make wudu him and his companion. Therefore, these are evidence from the sunnah of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam that is lawful to use the container of the kuffar, of the disbeliever, as long as they are pure, as long as they are clean. Therefore, when you come to the conclusion, both a hadith, so in hadith Abu Tha'laba, the Prophet ﷺ said, don't use it, except you don't find anyone. So this is hadith, it gives us the way how to behave or to think about this container. To not be, you know, very spontaneous on getting them. Someone need to watch first. You need to be watchful because they use them and they use a lot of najasa in it. فَيَحْطَاطُ الْإِنسَانُ فِيهَا فَلَا يَأْكُلُ فِي آنِيَةِ الْكُفَّارِ وَلَا يَشْرُبُ مِنْهَا إِلَّا أَنْ يَجِدَ غَيْرَهَا فَلْيَغْسِلَ ثُمَّ لِيَأْكُلْ فِيهَا. So he should not use them because it's most likely they're using the impurity in it. But if he has to do it or be presented for him, at least he will be sure that when he uses it, it's clean. And it's clean and it doesn't have any impurity in it. And this is what he said, قَالَ وَتُبَاهُ آنِيَةُ الْكُفَّارِ. وَتُبَاهُ آنِيَةُ الْكُفَّارِ. Now, it is lawful with the condition that we mentioned to use the utensils of the non-believer. قَالَ وَلَوْ لَمْ تَحِلَّ ذَذَائِحُهُمْ وَلَوْ لَمْ تَحِلَّ ذَذَائِحُهُمْ. Even though the owner of this container, their slaughtering of animals is not accepted, is not lawful for the believers. So here he's including other than the people of the book, because the slaughtering of animals by the people of the book is an exception for the believer to eat them, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned them in the ayah number 5 from Surah Al-Ma'idah. وَطَعَامُكُمْ حِلُّ وَطَعَامُهُمْ حِلُّ لَكُمْ. Now, if the people, for example, people are idol worshippers, pagans, even if they slaughter the animal, their meat that they slaughter is not halal for the Muslim. And they use it into, you know, their container. It is lawful to use their container. Yes, it is lawful because the container made out of substance that is pure, you can use it as long as you'll be sure before you use it that it is clean. And clean, we see that it doesn't have any impurity in it. So this is what it means, وَلَوْ لَمْ تَحِلَّ ذَبَائِحُهُمْ وَلَوْ لَمْ تَحِلَّ ذَبَائِحُهُمْ. Even though their ذَبَائِح, which is their slaughtering way, it's not accepted, it's not lawful for us. قَالَ يُبَاحُ اسْتَعْمَالُ أُوَانِيهِمْ وَلَوْ لَمْ تَحِلَّ ذَبَائِحُهُمْ وَأَنْ لَوْ لَمْ تَحِلَّ ذَبَائِحُهُمْ. Why he's saying this, the author, rahimahullah, because some of the scholars, they said, only lawful to use the utensils of the people of the book. And the people of the book, their food is accepted for us, is lawful for us. But in reality, no. The utensil, even for the non-people of the book, non-believers, is also halal, is also lawful to use with the condition we mentioned, as the author, rahimahullah ta'ala, mentioned. So you see, subhanAllah, every time he adds another details, it means there's difference of opinion between the scholars, and he's bringing his evidence as we mentioned. So, وَلَوْ لَمْ تَحِلَّ ذَبَائِحُهُمْ وَلَوْ لَمْ تَحِلَّ ذَبَائِحُهُمْ. Then he's saying, al-musannifu rahimahullah, وَثِيَابُهُمْ إِنْ جُهِلَ حَالُهَا وَثِيَابُهُمْ إِنْ جُهِلَ حَالُهَا. Their clothes, their garments, if we do not have any idea about their state, we don't know. So, if with this here, in جُهِلَ حَالُهَا, this is the shart, this is the condition. And when you look at the clothes, for the non-believer, it has three states. The first one, that is very brand new, non-used, so this is, we don't even talk about it. So this is, الْحُكْمُهَا الطَّهَارَةُ يَقِينًا. These clothes are clean and pure, certainly, but they've never been used, like the clothes you buy from the store, brand new. The second one is, أن ترى على ثوب الكافرين نجاسة. So you see on the clothes of the non-believer there's impurity. So this is certainly is impure. Now the problem we have in the clothes that been used and you don't see any impurity in it. And someone will, again, to remind ourselves why we're talking about these matters and these cases, because we are in the way of the Tahara. So you might not find any clothes to wear to offer your prayer. So what about the clothes of this category of people that they're not following our faith? So either they are very brand new, so this is here, we don't have any problem. The second one, if you see any impurity on it, therefore it's a najisa, you cannot use it. The third one is use it and you don't see any impurity on it. Here, some of the scholars, they say, and the question is, if these are impure, or these clothes impure, or are they impure? What is the answer? Some of the scholars, they say, ثِيَابُ الْكُفَّارِ يُعْمَلُ فِيهَا الْيَقِينَ. I mean, when we look at the clothes, it's certain that originally they were tahira, because they make out something from pure, so it's tahira, they are pure, they are clean. Till you see the najasa, and this is لا يزال اليقين بالشك, like we have the qa'idah of the fiqh, So clothes made out of cotton, of course they are pure. Unless you see the impurity on it, therefore this is becoming impure. The second opinion of the scholar, they say, most likely, al-dhahir, in the clothes of the non-believers, is impure. They say is impure. The clothes are impure. Why? He said, because they don't have the etiquette and the conduct of the cleanliness of the Muslim or the way of Islam. Therefore, when they do their need, they don't wash the way we wash, they don't do things. So there is no, in a way, we don't negate on them that they do not wash, but there's precaution in washing. There's no this being mindful in keeping the clothes and being watchful that nothing will touch the clothes from impurity. So most likely, this is, have a question mark. So if you like, it's not clean. And the conclusion of the scholar, they say, really it's someone need to, every case need some analysis and some details here. يقولون رحمه الله, this is what they saying, some of the scholar also contemporary scholars. قال إن كانت على موضع يغلب فيه النجاسة فهي نجسة كثياب التي تلي العورة. He said, let's make the analysis here. He said, if the clothes worn in a position or in the part of the body where there's close to the awra. So say most likely this is najisa. We don't use it. If something like a jacket or something, so this is, we make the clothes are originally clean. So if you don't see any impurity, so you can use them. And this is how they make the tafsir, these scholars in this mas'ala. Which has come to the conclusion, if someone is going to have used the clothes from non-believers, if they are clothed that they are, they touch the auras and everything, therefore need to be cleaned, like baths, like things like that. لِأَنَّ الْغَالِبَ فِيهِمْ أَنَّهُمْ لَا يَتَوَرَّعُونَ عَنِ النَّجَسَةِ. Because in the conduct among them, they are not watchful toward the impurities. And they don't clean themselves the way the Islamic faith, alhamdulillah, teaching us. But the rest, it will be most likely to be clean as long as you don't see any najas. And this is the ahkam, the rules concerning the thiyab, the clothes of the non-believers. Then يقول المصنف, then the author continue and saying, وَلَا يَطْهُرُ جِلْدُ مَيْتَةٍ بِدِبَاغٍ وَلَا يَطْهُرُ جِلْدُ مَيْتَةٍ بِدِبَاغٍ. The jildu al-mayta, the skin of a dead animals, cannot be purified by tanning. The tanning is to treat it, and they put salt in it, and even some coloring or without, but this is the tanning, which is at dibagh. According to the opinion of the author, treating the skin and to make it to be useful, which is called the tanning, and at dibagh, he said, لا يطهر. You cannot use it, because why? According to the opinion of the author, if it is dead animal, and the dead animal is impure, therefore anything from the dead animal is impure. You cannot use it. And here we have two known and famous opinion of the scholar concerning the skin of the animal. The jild of al-hayawan, like out of wool or the jild, like the goat skin, etc. And in reality, the strongest of the opinion, it is really becomes halal to use. So it's really not the opinion of the author. What is our evidence in this? So the author taking his opinion based on the origin, which is impure, therefore all the part of the impure is impure. Even though you get it into a process of changing it, according to the opinion of the author, of al-Musannif, is impure. But if it get into a process of changing, of cleanness, you clean it in a way that you really transform it in a way, transform it to be used, to get out of it all that, the thing that it has, you know, that blood and things, and to be clean and dried, and then used, that would be called the process of the tanning. In a hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and this is our evidence, قَالَ إِذَا دَبُغَ الْإِهَابُ أَوْ دُبِغَ الْإِهَابُ فَقَدْ طَهُرَ. In hadith, when the skin are treated with the way of the tanning, then he becomes pure, then becomes clean. And another hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he saw some of the people, a dragon, a maita, a goat died. Then they take it to get rid of it. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam talked to them. He said, قَالَ هَلَّا انْتَفَعْتُمْ بِإِهَابِهَا. Say, why you should not get benefit of the skin of the animals? إِهَابِهَا mean its skin. قَالُوا, they said, and in a narration it was a woman, قَالَتْ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ إِنَّهَا مَيِّتَةً or مَيْتَةً. He said, يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ, it's a dead animal. So the hukum, the ruling according to the companion that they know at the time, that is a dead animal, we cannot use its meat. You cannot eat the meat of a dead animal. Now, to extend the hukum, to extend this ruling to every part of the animals, that's what they did. So by analogy, we cannot eat the meat, we cannot use anything else. So that's why she said, Ya Rasulullah, innaha mayta. It's a dead. فَقَالَ النَّبِيُّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ قَالَ إِنَّمَا حُرِّمَ أَكْلُهَا. So he specified, what Allah made haram is eating it, not the use of the skin. He's eating it. So the use of the skin after الدباغ, after the tanning, is pure and halal, which is the strongest opinion. But the author in the book, he goes with the other opinion when he said, قَالَ وَلَا يَطْهُرُ جِلْدُ مَيْتَةٍ بِدِبَاغٍ. But the hadith that we mentioned is a hadith sahih. It's a hadith sahih. And it has a proof and evidence that the skin of the mayta, of the dead animal, can be purified with the dibar, with the tanning. The opinion of the author is based on a hadith narrated by Al-Imam Ahmad that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he sent to Juhayna when they accepted Islam to give them instruction. And in the letter that he sent, قَالَ أَلَّا تَنْتَفِعُ مِنَ الْمَيْتَةِ بِإِهَابٍ وَلَا عَصَبٍ. You should not use from the dead animal anything, including the skin. But now we go to Ahlul Hadith, the people and the scholars of the Hadith, what they say about the Hadith. They say this Hadith is مُضْطَرِب. It has a problem in its narration. Even Al-Imam Ahmad rahimahullah ta'ala, as being narrated by Al-Tirmidhi, he went to make this hadith, like he changed his opinion concerning the skin of the animal, of a dead animal, after realizing that this hadith is muftarab. Then the conclusion is the skin of the dead animal, according to the hadith of Sahih, can be used and can be purified with ad-dibar. So if someone, for example, have a goat And before, usually, there's a lot of accident that happen. They put them, for example, on a high place, and the goat fall or things, or the animal gets strangled and he died before even the slaughtering. So if someone, something happened to him like that, he can take out the skin and use the skin after the tanning, and this is halal. Then Al-Musannif rahimahullah, he continued and he said, وَقَالَ وَيُبَاحُ اسْتِعْمَالُهُ بَعْدَ الدَّبْغِ فِي يَابِسٍ مِنْ حَيَوَانٍ طَاهِيرٍ فِي الْحَيَاةِ وَيُبَاحُ, and it's lawful, استعماله, to use it. We're talking about the skin of the animal. بَعْدَ الدَّبْغِ, after the process of cleaning. بَعْدَ الدَّبْغِ, which is the tanning. فِي يَابِسٍ, you can use it as a container to store in it substance that are yabis. And the yabis is something like, it's not soft, the opposite of soft. So it's like structured rigid. في يابس من حيوان طاهر في الحياة. So the condition for the author to use the skin of animal, it is after the process of the tanning, and the skin of an animal that was halal in time of his life. So for example, the skin of animal like the pork, it's haram to use it. And according to the scholars, what was in the life najis in the self, there stays najis after death. So the skin of the goat, of the lamb, of the cow, of the camel, they are tahira, they are pure when the animal is alive. But when they died, they become impure because of the way of the death. As long as they were pure before, you can bring it back to cleanliness and purity through the process of the tanning. But if the animal in the beginning was rigid, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala called the pig to be all of it rigid. So وَعَيْنُهُ رَجِسًا, it's not the meat, or it's all rigid. So even if you slaughter the pig, the skin cannot be used if he has a skin. But this is to say, so this is what he said, حَيَوَانٍ طَاهِرٍ فِي الْحَيَاةِ. So we're talking about the skin of animal that we can use it after tanning, as long as this hayawan, this animal, was pure and halal in time of his life. Only use it for yams. Only use it in yams. And yams, something that is rigid. Now, according to the author, rahimahullah, he's going through his opinion. Because what's the difference between something rigid or something soft? According to the author, it is impure, even though after the tanning is still impure. But the exception, you cannot use it for something rigid, because the rigid cannot be, have any impact or effect from the skin to get its impurity. But when something is soft or liquid and get inside the container that is made out of that skin, and that liquid will be touching it and store in it, then it's going to take some of the effect of the skin. According to his opinion, is impure, then it's going to affect that liquid or soft substance, make it impure. That's why he said rigid. That's why he said yes. So here he's continuing this sentence based on his opinion. When we came to the conclusion that it is pure. It's either you put in it soft or not soft, or liquid or not liquid, is halal, is pure. Okay? Then he continued, rahimahullah ta'ala, said, قَالَ وَيُبَاحُ اسْتَعْمَالُهُ بَعْدَ الدَّبْغِ فِي يَابِسٍ مِّنْ حَيَوَانٍ طَاهِرٍ فِي الْحَيَاةِ. So this particular one, we mentioned why he mentioned only yabis, because he is following up with his own opinion that it cannot be the skin of the dead anymore, cannot be purified even with the tank. But we mentioned the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ and the stronger opinion that is the strongest in this mas'ala, in this case. ثم قال ولبنها وكل أجزائها نجسة غير شعر ونحوه. Now, the rest part of the animal, the rest part of the animal, you're gonna find the milk and all the parts of the animals. All of them are impure. All of them are impure. So we don't have any problem, because even the milk, they say the milk, it's not part of the animal, because it is stored there. Because, but we said it's stored in a place where everything is around it is dead. So it has an effect, so it's going to be also najis. So it cannot be used. Talking about a goat, for example, died, mate, and it has still milk. So that is haram. And all the parts of it is haram. He make the exception here, rahimahullah ta'ala, غَيْرُ شَاعَرٍ أَوْ نَحْوٍ. Except the hair. Except the hair. Or نَحْوِهِ, or something like it. We're talking about the wool for the sheep, something like that. أَوْ الْوَبَرُ, for the skin, wabar is the skin of the camel, the wool of the skin of the camel. Now, the scholar they taken, why the exception of the hair or of the wool? He, the scholar, they make difference between the parts in the animal or in the body. قَالَ مِنْهُمْ مَنْ تَسْرِي فِيهِ الْحَيَاةِ وَمِنْهُمْ لَا تَسْرِي فِيهِ الْحَيَاةِ. الْحَيَاةُ is life. There's part of the body where life goes into the cells, into the organ, into the body part, and some it doesn't go in it. The difference is the thing that it has hayat, if you try to carry it, it hurts. The thing doesn't has life, if you try to carry it, it doesn't hurt. If you try to cut the fingernails, it doesn't hurt. So we say it doesn't have hayat in it. Doesn't have life in it. But they grow, but doesn't have life. The hair, the same thing. You cut your hair. But if you want someone to do that for his finger, he cannot, because it has hayat in it. So based on that, how that's why the scholars, they make the exclusion, they exclude the sha'r from the maita, because he's not part of the ajah of the maita. So the sha'r, the hair or the wool, it didn't have life in it before the death, and it stays after the death. So the state of the hair or the wood didn't change, it's the same. As you can use it and cure before death, the same thing you can use it after death, because life wasn't taken away from it. So if the animal was killed, it will not have any effect on the wool or the hair, because the hair is the same. Wasn't affected by the change of the status of the life, because they didn't have life from the beginning. And you see, when they shave the animals and they take their wools, it doesn't affect the animals. So the same is saying, even after death, you can use the hair or the wool or the skin or what is on the skin of the animal. قال غير شاعر ونحو. And this is why we take and put on the side the sha'r from the maita, because it doesn't have life, as we explained. And the dalil, of course, is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saying in Surah An-Nahl, ayah number 8, number 80, that you, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, wallahu ja'ala lakum min buyutikum sakana, وَمِنْ جُلُودِ الْأَنْعَامِ بُيُوتًا تَسْتَخِفُّونَهَا يَوْمَ وَعْدِكُمْ وَيَوْمَ إِقَامَتِكُمْ وَمِنْ أَصْوَافِهَا وَأَوْبَارِهَا وَأَشْعَارِهَا أَثَاثًا وَمَتَاعًا لَكُمْ وَمِنْ أَصْوَافِهَا and al-awdar, it is the skin of the camel, and the sha'r is the hair, the skin of the goat. You made out of it things for yourself to use as, you know, either clothes or rags or towels or things that you can use. You can make use out of it, tents, all of that. So this is the use of it is pure. And we explained that. That's why al-Musannifu, when he mentioned the skin of the animal, then he mentioned the condition according to his opinion, how to use it. And then he said, every other part of the dead animal is not lawful because it's mayta, so it's impure. Except the hair, aw nahwihi, or something like it, like the wool or the skin of the wool of the camel, al-wabar. قَالَ غَيْرُ شَعْرٍ وَنَحْوِهِ. So here to give us the exception for us to know that that part is not impure. وَمَا أُبِينَ مِنْ حَيٍّ فَهُوَ كَمَيْتَةٍ وَمَا أُبِينَ مِنْ حَيٍّ فَهُوَ كَمَيْتَةٍ. And whatever been cut off from a live animal, it is considered mayta, dead animal. You cannot use it, haram. You cannot use it, it's haram. And this part, وَمَا أُبِينَ مِنْ حَيٍّ فَهُوَ كَمَيْتَةٍ, it is hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So he really put the hadith exactly as is. لأن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال, مَا أُبِينَ مِنْ حَيٍّ فَهُوَ مَيْتَةٍ أو فَهُوَ مَيِّتٍ. Whatever been, take off from a live animal. كرام. Now, here we have tafsir. I mean, we go into details. If the animal is halal, and if dead as mayta, and the mayta of this animal is haram, whatever you cut from the animal, like someone, you know, the animal had an accident and his leg broke, so they cut off his leg. And he continued to live with the rest of his legs. What is the hukum of this leg? This leg is haram, is mayta. Why? Because this animal, if he died, everything is haram. So if part of it is being cut off and kind of died this way, so it's haram. If the mayta of that animal is halal, therefore whatever you cut from the mayta, from this animal, alive is halal, the big fish. If you cut the tail of the big fish and he continue to live, the tail is halal. Why? Because the mayta of the fish is halal. Al-hillu al-tahuru ma'u al-hillu maytatu. But any other animal that we know that we slaughter, like the cattle we know, if anything cut off from in their life, it is mayta, cannot be used. As the Prophet ﷺ قَالَ مَا أُبِينَ مِنْ حَيٍّ فَهُوَ مَيِّتٍ. مَا أُبِينَ مِنْ حَيٍّ فَهُوَ مَيِّتٍ. And the author, he said, قَالَ وَمَا أُبِينَ مِنْ حَيٍّ فَهُوَ كَمَيْتَةٍ. It's like a dead animal. We start, continue بإذن الله. يقول المصنف رحمه الله باب الاستنجاء. باب الاستنجاء. And we mentioned the meaning of the باب. So we have a باب, فتحة, an opening that we're going to get into the what the scholar is going to tell us about the subject of الاستنجاء. الاستنجاء. In the sharh, al-istinja'u, coming from the root word al-najwu, al-najwu, noon, jim, thumma, waw, najwun. Al-najwu mean to stop or to cut. So someone, he's in action and he stops it. Based on that, when someone, he's I saw some of the translation and I liked the way some of the author, he translated the ayah in the Quran when someone he is doing his need. Qal, he said, answering the call of the nature. So we use that, inshallah. So when someone is answering the call of the nature, either urinating or doing his need, when he stops, that the stopping to cut the action by the end, that called najm. Based on that, they call it قَطْعُ الْبَوْلِ وَالْغَائِطِ بِالْمَاءِ وَالْحِجَارَةِ. When he stopped, how can you fully, you know, be sure that he stopped after you clean it? So you cut off any traces of impurity with the cleaning. That action called istinja. So how someone, when he's doing his need and come to his end, this end, to stop it, we need to stop it by cleanliness. Because if someone, like, you know, the non-believer who not following the practice of the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they don't do anything. And this is one of the reason of the punishment in the grave we're going to mention. So to finish the action of answering the call of the nature, he needs someone to clean. That action is istinja. Therefore, al-mukallafu, when he will do that, he will have fulfilled the cleanliness. And with this cleanliness, he did what? He azal al-najasa. See, نحن الطهارة قلنا رفع الحدث وإزالة الخبث. So here we are talking about the second type of cleanliness, which is إزالة الخبث. إزالة الخبث, to remove impurities. And we know that our condition in our cleanliness is to be sure of both the cleanliness. The cleanliness of al-hadath that we mentioned, we've been studying the waters, and then the cleanliness of al-khabath, and this is what we're studying here. So you see how coherent the way of the author to introduce every subject to help someone getting ready till he'll come to the prayer with all the knowledge required for that. And when we're talking about the istinja, we are caring about the cleanliness of the clothes, and the body. And in this part, we have clothes, body, and place. Clothes, body, and place, when we're talking about رَفْعِ الْخَبَثِ or إِزَالَةِ الْخَبَثِ, رَفْعُ الْحَدَثِ وَإِزَالَةِ الْخَبَثِ. Some of the scholars, they call this chapter, or this bab, بَابُ الْإِسْتِنْجَاءِ, as in the author he called it. Other scholars, they call it Babu Adabi Qada'i al-Haja, the chapter of the etiquette of how to someone relieve oneself or answer the call of the nature. Some other scholars, they call it Babu al-Khala, Babu al-Khala, or Adabu al-Khala. And all of that we're going to see. So qada'u al-haja, the etiquette, and adabu al-khala. Al-khala, empty space, open space, open field, that's the khala. That's the khala. And we say baytul khala, also the baytul khala, the closet, the water closet that been built specially for the action of someone doing his deed. And then al-khala, which is the meaning of it, the open space, is being used in this chapter to say even when someone was going to the bathroom, they call the place of the khala, the place of the khala. But the khala is the meaning of the open space, and this is, we make the difference because we'll have different ahkam, insha'Allah, in that. And they saying, the Prophet ﷺ saying in hadith, إِذَا قَعْدَ أَحَدُكُمْ لِحَاجَتِهِ, when someone said to do his need, that we say haja, need, haja, need, that's why they call بَابُ أَدَابُ قَضَاءُ الْحَاجَةِ, بَابُ أَدَابُ قَضَاءُ الْحَاجَةِ. The etiquette of getting into the bathroom or someone, you know, to relieve himself, oneself has three parts. The first part, the etiquette before you get to the place, let's say, you know, talk about, you know, which is our common for us, get to the bathroom. The etiquette while doing someone's need, and the etiquette after finishing the need. After finish or someone to relieve himself from his need. And all of this, a hadith of the Prophet ﷺ being mentioned in it. And other etiquette being extracted from the usul of the Sharia, from the intent and the roots of the Sharia. يقول المصنف, as we said, باب الاستنجاء. It means in this chapter, I'm going to talk to you about some of the ahkam of the rules, ahkam al-shar'iyya, related to al-istinja. He's saying, he's starting, قَالَ يُسْتَحَبُّ عِنْدَ دُخُولِ الْخَلَاءِ قَوْلُ بِسْمِ اللَّهِ أَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ مِنَ الْخُبْثِ وَالْخَبَائِثِ. So this is the etiquette before to get to the bathroom. يَقُولُ يُسْتَحَبُّ, يُسْتَحَبُّ, it is preferred, it is recommended that someone before entering the bathroom, he should say, in the name of Allah, I seek refuge from al-khabath wal-khaba'ith, al-khabath wal-khaba'ith. And the hadith in a sahihain, the hadith narrated by Anas radiallahu ta'ala anhu, qal, كان النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم إذا دخل الخلاء قال اللهم إني أعوذ بك من الخبث والخبث وفي رواية الخبائث. This is the wording exactly of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. The scholar, the author had here said, Bismillah, A'udhu Billahi min al-khubthi wal-khabath. But the hadith saying, Allahumma inni a'udhu bika min al-khubthi wal-khabath. Wa hadha thabitu. The word of Bismillah is mentioned in another hadith. In another hadith. Fi sunan, that someone, when he's going to lift his clothes, he will say Bismillah. So the author combined between them, Bismillah, A'udhu Billahi min al-khubthi wal-khaba'ith, and we can say for both hadith combined, Bismillah, Allahumma, Allahumma, as the hadith say, A'udhu bika min al-khubthi wal-khaba'ith. There is a hadith or a narration saying, when you say this dua, you being covered from the eye of the jinn to not look at your awa. Hadith that been, you know, يقول الفقهاء متكلم فيه, is being talked about, that is not strong hadith. But we mention it as being narrated. Therefore, it is mustahab, recommended, for someone to say it when he enter al-khala, when he enter the bathroom. We have a question. When someone should say it? Because it's either someone is going to get to a bathroom, or someone traveling, and there's no bathroom. Like before, traveling in an open land, which we call al-khala. But now someone be traveling, he really has an extreme need to relieve oneself. He stopped the car and in the place empty, he want to do his needs. Where he's going to do the dhikr? When he's going to do the dhikr? If he's going to enter a structure, building structure, he will enter with the left foot. And before entering, he say the dua, or while get before to get to the end. If someone in an open field, and there's no structure, walls, when he's going down to lift his clothes, that's what he going to say. Which this make us a clear hukm about the bathrooms we have. So someone who should we say it when he enter the bathroom, when there's the sinks, or when he's going to do it in the, when we have the mirhab, place of the bathroom. And here we can apply this hukm. Because if the toilet itself is separate from the sinks, then before you get to the toilet, you say the dua. But what if the bathroom had the sinks and the shower and the place of the toilet? Therefore, the dua will be said according like you are in khala. Because if you enter the bathroom, then when you wudu, you cannot even say Bismillah. You're going to say Bismillah. So we are inside a place where I should not talk, as we is going to see the etiquette. But we've taken this both, way of saying it, and in this modern time that we live in, and the way of the bathrooms, there's bathroom now with no details. So it's very big bathrooms, which is also applying the message, for example, in the bathroom we have here. So someone, when he going to say it, or when someone making wudu, that's called bathroom or toilet. So based on this, if the toilet is closed, when he entered to do it, so it's only mukhassasa, it's being specified, it's being reserved for qada al-hajj, for someone's need. That's you say the dua before it. And that place will require from us to observe the etiquette of qada al-hajj. If the space is open, it's even open space or open field, or open room, which has faucets and has shower, have the toilet, then the dua need to be said before someone will go to do, fulfill his need. Fulfill his need. Continue here. قال هذا دعاء نبوي مأثور صحيح. And this is dua, is a great dua, because this is dua taught by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And it's dua because it protects us. This dua protect us from al-jinn wa shayatin. Because we want to say what is the meaning of al-khubthi wal-khabath. We seek refuge with Allah from al-khubthi wal-khabath. We have two saying of the scholars, rahimahumullah ta'ala, in the meaning of it. The first saying, al-khubth is the mal of the shayateen mal. Wal-khaba'ith, the female of the shayateen. So we seek refuge with Allah from the shayateen, their male and female. Adhanallahu wa iyyakum. وَقِيلَ الْخُبْثِ, and also we say الْخُبْثِ is evil, sharp, bad things. وَالْخَبَائِثِ are the shayateen. Of course, al-jinnu, among them good and among them bad. The good one, when you say good, there are those who believe in Allah, Muslims. And those who do not believe in Allah, those are shayateen. So the shayateen, are the jinn non-believers, soldiers of Iblis, la'anahum Allahu ajma'in. The attraction of these lives, this jinn, this type of jinn, is to be around the places of khabath, of impurity. Where the angels, they don't enter to these places, except by darura. Darura is like they're going to be forced, something happened, they need to record it. As in the hadith of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, the angels, they get bothered from what the human being get bothered from. If smoke bother you, the angels bother them. If bad smell bother you, also the angels. So everything that bothers the son of Adam, it bothers the angels. So the angels, they will not enter and they will not see the hour, unless they be forced. Who stay there and around there is are the shayateen. So someone, when he's going to have his haja, he's going to be surrounded by the shayateen. So he asks Allah to protect them from them. From them. This is very important, because hadith of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, and we believe in that. We believe, and this is part of our faith. Based on this, we say, so this hadith, this dua, is being recommended to us in the hadith of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, and it is from the etiquette of qada'ul haja. He said, يستحب عند دخول الخلاء قوله بسم الله أعوذ بالله من الخبث والخبائث وعند الخروج منها. Now he gives us, when you leave the bathroom or the place of the خلاء, you say غفران, يا الله, your forgiveness. And he say, Allah, alhamdulillah, الذي أذهب عني الأذى وعافاني. Praise be to Allah, who took away from me harm, وعافاني. And he gave me to be in this great state of health. State of health, عافاني. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala prevent anything bad to happen. غفرانك. It has a big question mark. Someone left the bathroom, he say, Ya Allah, your forgiveness. Ghufranak. Al-maghfiratu comes from the verb ghafara. And ghafara means to cover things. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, yaghfiru dhunuba, it covered them, subhanAllah. Covered them to the point they will not, and they do not exist, you cannot see them, because Allah moved them. But they're not fully erased. They will be fully erased in the Day of Judgment, as the scholar they say, because that's the difference between al-maghfirat wal-afu. Al-afu is full erase. Al-maghfirah is covered. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will show to his servant, say, read, and he read the sin. And he said, Ya Allah, I prayed you to forgive it. He said, yes, and today I erase it. It turned into light. That's when the scholar, they say the meaning, قَالْ أُولَئِكَ يُبَدِّلُ سَيِّئَاتِهِمْ حَسَنَاتِ. He changed the سَيِّئَة, bad deeds, into good deeds. That would happen when someone is before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, know that he accepted his dua. That's the meaning of غفران. قَالْ غُفْرَانَكْ is ثَبَتَ. It is being proven from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that he said غفرانك عند الخروج من الخلاء. And the scholar, they have different saying of the wisdom of saying غفرانك, and to check and to analyze what is the wisdom behind the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam saying غفرانك after the خلاء. And this is an etiquette for us and a great way to understand or to learn the way of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Some of them, they said that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, while doing his need, he was busy in that state and didn't do the dhikr of Allah. Because he was doing his deen. Thereby not doing the remembrance of Allah in that moment, when he left, he asked Allah forgiveness for a small moment that he passed from his life without remembrance. And as he's saying, one of the shurah, that the meaning of hasanatul abrari sayyiatul muqarrabin. The good deeds of the righteous are often the sins for the high ranks close to Allah. So when someone make a dhikr, 50% of his day he think like one of the highest rank. But the Prophet ﷺ, he didn't make dhikr for the time of the khala. He, for him is something that is very big. So he asked, require maghfirah from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is كما يقول هنا من كمال عبوديته لله سبحانه وتعالى وكمال حبه وتعلقه بالله. This is from the whole complete and excellent and perfect servitude of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم to Allah and his complete and perfect love to Allah سبحانه وتعالى. And this is with the need of the body, because this is the right of the body to be fulfilled, because without it, someone subhanallah is going to be it's really very serious. I mean, someone will die. Someone will not have that possibility to get out that filth from his own body. It's death. And here comes the hadith of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. It's a ni'ma, subhanAllah. Alhamdulillah, الذي أذهب عني الأذى. That Allah took away this adha from me. What if someone cannot get it out? One of the khulafa, inshallah, I will tell you the story after Salat al-Maghrib. Inshallah, we'll take a break for Salat al-Maghrib and we'll come back.